Jerry, is he coming?
I thought from the email traffic that he was coming.
Yeah, I thought he was too.
Yeah.
But I haven't, I realized I didn't remind him, and he said that he was busy with grandchildren and stuff, so.
Well, that was last week, so I don't know if that continued until this week or not, so.
He was gonna be going down to Florida, so I'm assuming he's here, but I haven't heard anything from him as a confirmation.
I can give a call if you want, or just keep going, I mean, it's the matter.
No, it'll be a short meeting or a longer meeting, depending on whether he comes or not.
Yep.
So regarding meeting minutes, we got a couple of things from John, it was Ted's notes from December 5th.
Yeah, Ted's notes from both those missing meetings were excellent.
Yeah, I don't know where I sent that, a lot of them.
Okay, I mean, as I said, a lot of them were just my notes to myself, so I don't know if you.
They were much more thorough than.
Right.
Okay.
And legible.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, because I had a little trouble with my handwriting. But I think as far as minutes are concerned, and they were also, when John and I looked at the ones that we voted on last week, there are some, a few more tweaks that really should be.
Yeah, Ted had forwarded a couple of those things.
Right, and I had some, so I would probably re-vote those, but we don't have them today. What I would like to suggest, actually, for the minutes is the notes that you guys have done are so detailed, and they're great, and I think they're really good for us as follow-up, but they, the minutes need to be formalized in terms of, you know, who made a motion to adjourn and any other motions that,
Yep.
that are made, and I think they could be kind of categorized as sort of more, some more general conversation as opposed to being quite as detailed as they are.
Okay, so did we record any of those actions?
I did in mine, like who, you know, who voted to, who made the motion to appoint you as the CTC rep and stuff like that.
Yep.
So, and who made the motion to adjourn, so I have those, and then I think if we can kind of boil these down into general topics like discussion about membership, discussion about, you know, status of the Four Town project or whatever, then probably not. Some of these are really notes for us to follow up on, we don't necessarily need to.
Okay.
Record them, so.
So what do you suggest, somebody compile them into a single?
I mean, I could do.
Organized list as like an addendum to the official minutes or something, or?
Well, since these haven't been voted on yet, they're not official, so what I'd like to suggest, if you guys are okay, is to kind of reformat these into a more official format with the motions and stuff like that. I could do something as a template, I could take one of these and do a template, is that any helpful?
Sure. Yep. Do you do as a template, then John or I or two of us together would then reformat it in that template?
Yeah, I mean, if that would be, okay, and just make sure that we get who makes the motions and all that stuff.
Right.
So that would be super. But that said, I don't know if you guys want to go through these as items to be followed, I mean, there's a lot of them kind of standing items that we've been writing forward.
Yeah.
So you can print them out if you want, we can just kind of.
I would say me too.
Okay. All right. The next item is talking with Jerry, since he's not here yet, but we can move on. I have not heard anything under old business. I haven't heard anything back from Chris Ruth regarding the MOU and the comments the town council had made about, you know, largely that payment for additional services added scope. So I guess that's still outstanding. But did you all see the email that we're on to meet with them next Monday, the 16th?
Yep.
I
So that's, well, their regular meeting is the following week.
They moved it.
Oh, I missed that.
Yeah, or I think that's what.
The one, the last one I saw was they weren't able to move it, so I guess I missed that last one.
Yeah, so they did.
Where's the meeting?
It's gonna be in Georgetown.
Uh-huh.
I think so.
Second floor, you know, that, yeah, the building that used to be like an elementary school, it's now the town hall.
Right, right, I think it's at seven, so.
PM?
Yeah, I thought you guys all got the email, but if not, I'll send it.
I'm trying to stay away from the computer.
And Chris said that he would try to reach John Hendrickson, the interim Stantec, to see if he can be there or at least provide an update. So I will post that, assuming that we will be a quorum there, I'll post that as a joint meeting with Georgetown.
We had a contract of $39,353, Ellen? That's what I got.
So I'm not sure if there's anything he wants to discuss about Georgetown.
$33,955.
Yep, that was a lot more.
Wait a minute, we paid them. Oh, so that's what we were doing. Okay.
And committee membership, I will confess I have not had a chance to follow up on that.
I sent Christine an email and I tried to call her a couple of times, I don't know if they're aware of it. She hasn't got back to me yet. I go back far enough, so I think she would have called me if she had the possibility.
I included my email to Jerry, I included David Hall on copy and asked him if he could remember the person that he'd mentioned months ago.
How about David?
Didn't, how about David himself, that, yeah, that's a, he's a good guy. Let me, I'll just call him. Yeah, do it professionally.
You certainly don't wear a medal with it.
Yeah, I know he's a busy guy, but.
Yeah, he always has a lot going on.
Yeah.
But is Elizabeth going to send out an email, you know, then from CTC to people at Newbury?
Yes, and she wanted to have it, her be the one to send it out.
Yeah, this is her list.
Yeah, of course, yeah, yeah, so, but yeah, she responded. It's on copy to her response, but she's all for it.
Yeah, it occurs to me that it might be kind of thing that you don't just send it once, that you kind of pound it a few times.
Yep.
Over the course of a couple of months. Mm-hmm. And finally, it's sort of like, you know, public radio fundraising, you know, you
yeah.
finally make someone feel guilty enough.
Yeah, that yeah.
They do something.
They turn the station too many times. Okay, I'm gonna get there.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's a good point. But I think the other thing we were talking about doing was actually looking through the list of Newbury residents and
yeah.
trying to just see if there's anybody that jumps out. So
okay. And
I did think she said she'd be willing to share that, and you know, obviously not.
And we did have our own.
And we did, and that was in my court to pull that out, but
yeah.
I haven't done that. So still need to talk to some other partner or thinker, so I should be able to. I'll be seeing her later this week, so I should be able to just kind of get a sense of.
I'm going to ask them to take some kind of vote, even if it's just a straw vote.
Well, I think having an informal sense first of where they stand might be enough. I don't know what you guys think.
Well, who was the head of Park River now? Is it Long or is it?
No, it's, I'm totally blanking on his name. It was George and it's not George anymore.
Jack, is it?
No, he's not.
think I've met him.
Is he a Newbury resident?
No, Newburyport.
Yeah, okay, so.
George Kaminsky is there, he's the former president of East Georgetown. Norm Rain is their treasurer, he's Newbury. Rob Stevenson is the director, he's Newburyport. Jack is actually Newburyport.
Jack who?
Jack Edlon.
If I remember correctly, I think Jerry had been involved with Coastal Trails early on. But he'd be a person that, you know, since he's not Newbury, so it wouldn't be eligible for the committee, but he'd give you a read as to how they as a group feel about the project.
Right, right. Well, I was going to talk to Yvonne about it.
Well, she'd probably be a better person than that part of it.
Yeah, right. And,
I like Yvonne, but she's always the worst case scenario person.
But we've walked the trail. And so, I'll just talk to her and get a, see if I can get a read.
Okay.
Okay, anything else on membership right now?
I mean, would it make sense for one of us to be the point person on that to needle everybody else to?
Sure. You want to send out reminders?
Sure. Yeah.
So I guess partly that will come out of our meeting with Georgetown.
Yeah.
And sort of what we learned at that. What I can do is give Ellen a heads up that we may want to be on the selectmen's agenda for the 24th. This month.
Okay.
And wait until after that joint meeting.
I'd have to let her know by next
right.
Wednesday.
I had been dusting off old computer files, which I didn't know they collected dust inside the hard drive.
What they do?
For the, you know, basically starting with the grant application that Christine and I had done to institution, because that has essentially a write-up about the whole thing, you know, pretty much in our words that we put together. I think that might be a good start of just some type of document to have for the selectmen to look over and kind of, you know, not overly detailed but informative. We can add in or update it after the joint meeting with Georgetown, and I think that I'll try and light a fire under myself to have that, like, you know, readied for dropping, you know, up to date. As it stands right now, then we'll add in anything after Georgetown and then go from there.
Okay.
But what I'll do is when I have it, I'll email it to them while, you know, look it over and offer comments and offer anything you think we should change, you know, go from there.
Okay. No, I think that would be great because, you know, in fact, I think Jeff is the only one who's still on the board who was
remembers involved. Yes.
Yeah, so not sure how much the other selectmen are even aware of the project at this point. So I'm sure all of them have heard about it to some
yeah.
or another, but probably not too much familiarity. So yeah, I mean I think the background information for the IFS grant application would be good, and then and everything that's happened over the past couple of years, splitting the project into four, all of that would be all the new stuff.
Maybe just a timeline would be Although it'd be lengthy and sparse.
Yeah. Don't get a little scar.
Maybe not, then.
Yeah, there'd be a lot of gaps in there.
Yeah.
Like, I'm not, I'd have to go back now, and I'm not quite sure. I think it was 2 years ago that it got split into the four separate projects instead of being the one project, but I'm not sure.
Okay. So the main thing is where we are now and what the issues are and what the
right.
Where we are in that.
Tying that into the report to the Swike map, I think we ought to just put that a section in there also, just talk about what things we would like to see happen, you know, going forward in a few decades. We want it to happen in Steve's lifetime.
Better be quick.
So what I've been told on that, originally, DOT was going to fund the feasibility study for doing that, so going Church Street down the rest of the 95, or rest of the right of way, 95 to South Street, Scotland Road. The last time I talked to Emily about this, she said that we would be responsible for the cost ourselves, and we would have to contact Stantec.
Potential responsible for the cost of
the
feasibility study. Okay.
Right.
Yeah.
So that doesn't even cover design and construction.
Yeah.
So Christine and I actually walked it with Pat Huckery and John Hendrickson and Elise D'Onofrio from Stantec. God knows how many years ago. And you know, there are some issues along there. There's a pretty significant wetland crossing right where the National Grid right of way hits 95.
Yeah, you can see that.
Yeah, and we had hoped at one point, actually it was Joe Story's suggestion, to perhaps incorporate that some sort of crossing into the solar project.
I was going to ask about the solar project. Intersects.
Yeah, and I think for many reasons that's not feasible. I mean, the design has been permitted, it's been appealed, or the special permit was issued, it's been appealed, so. But their attempt was to minimize any wetland impact with that. So that said, I think we'd have to find some other way to deal with that. Awesome. The other issues where there's some significant areas of ledge within the right of way. Pat Huckery at the time did say that she was open to considering having the trail go into Fish and Wildlife property along there to avoid some of those other wetland crossings and ledge. But you know, I think until we actually have a feasibility study, what we're dealing with.
What kind of ledge? Just like
huge outcroppings.
Oh wow! That the railroad just dealt with somehow, or did they?
No, they're the 95 right of way.
Oh, the 95
right
of way.
Yeah, not the National Grid right.
Oh, all right. Yeah.
Yeah. No, the National Grid is all five, except for the wetlands.
Yeah.
That's a pretty good idea. If you could create a path along the boundary between wildlife management area and the private housing, because you can't shoot there anyhow.
Yeah.
I never thought about that. That's true.
But we'll see. So
maybe Pat can put it on the bus.
I'm not sure about that. But the first step would be to get a fee proposal from John Hendrickson at Stan Tech. And then figure out, depending on what it is, how we might be able to fund it. But I was disappointed because in earlier meeting when we go into at DOT, they were very keen on that idea because they recognize that going up Main Street and South Street is just tremendously dangerous.
Yep.
And so they did say at that time that they would fund a feasibility study, but obviously things have changed.
Yeah. So my notes from a previous conversation with you or Jerry said that the possibility of actually having it like on the 95 right away was considered, that
yeah.
they were concerned about the fumes.
Well, it was the Department of Public Health was concerned about the fumes from the cars.
Yeah.
And DOT's position at that point was that they felt the safety of the bicyclists, you know, getting them off road was more important. So, yeah, they really were keen on seeing this happen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, there's places where it's done. I mean,
uh-huh.
I mean, the turnpike.
Yeah.
It is done. All right, so we'll ask Stan Tech.
Yeah, so assuming John Hendrickson is at the meeting next week, or I could try to call him ahead of time.
Yes. All right. It might be, I mean, I'm wondering if this state DOT kind of backed off on it because the budget issues that they just, you know, weren't told, no, no. Hold back any things that we haven't committed to. That's the issue. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, the change happened once it went from being the four town project into four separate projects.
Oh, I see.
And
oh,
now
okay.
they're totally, you know, the cost of the project has expanded greatly, mostly because of the bridge construction costs. But they're bearing that entire cost.
Who usually pays for feasibility studies on transportation projects?
DOT or Merrimack?
Yeah, so DOT or does it come through Merrimack Valley Planning? Or, I mean, is it, I'm trying to think of like, you know, is there another little gold mine we can try and dig in or something?
Right, I mean,
well, that's what I was half joking when I said Pat could put it in our budget. That's a recreation area.
Yeah.
And this is certainly recreation.
Mm-hmm.
You just don't want them going down the middle of it because right. they'll be on somebody's foot like a deer.
Yeah.
You know, if we can somehow make a joint project between DOT and fishing game.
Now, is that whole area on this side of 95 that
going?
You can't shoot it.
Both sides,
yeah,
well,
so the smaller part of the Martin Burns is on the
stuff on
west
the other side.
On,
is
yeah.
like,
we're talking about the west side.
The west side.
Yeah. So, but on this side, it's too small and too surrounded that you would the whole area is off limits to shooting.
When you say on this side, would
the west side.
Yeah.
You can't shoot within 500 miles of a paved road. 500 feet.
And so it's got south, it's got 95. And so any trail coming in, just if there is a 500 foot, like, you know, the size of this room area in there that you can still shoot in, it might eliminate that.
Well, I can rush to shoot birds and deer in
them. Yeah. This would be helpful, man. My map, be looking at the map to
have a discussion. I was talking about the east side of 95. I mean, that goes all the way down to right along the edge. I mean, I
along
assume
the edge as opposed to along the National Grid right away, or whatever, the old
no,
railroad.
Not the railroad.
Right, because that's the easy solution, but keep it up. Understand.
I'm talking about right along the edge of the driveway can go right up to the
and then the property street in Whitefield.
I assume that a walking path can go right to the property line too, since that's what we're doing on this.
Mm-hmm.
So if you put it on she gained land right at the property line. You can't shoot there anyhow because you're too close to housing. It should be a safety zone.
Right, there's a lot of wetlands there though.
Well, it's high.
And one of the thoughts about going up the southbound side, so the west side, was to avoid the 95 crossing. But maybe an alternative, and I don't know if this is what you're thinking, is if people land in a byfield, they cross 95 there and then go up the east side.
Mm-hmm. So go up Fruit Street and then.
That's not exactly what I had planned and thinking, but I don't know how far Fruit Street go all the way to the management area.
Pretty close, yeah.
I've
hiked 2 Fruit Street from the. Well,
you don't have any new feasibility study about the western side because that's done for you. Mm-hmm. Right on Fruit Street.
Yeah, I wish I had my map here. But that's an interesting idea to think about rather than going all the way down to the end of the National Grid right away and dealing with that big wetland there.
But you say it's high, but it's, when you drive north from exit 55 on the right, there's some, as we look at it all the time, because there's these big old dead trees with all the birds nesting on the top. I think that's still
right. Yeah, no, that's.
And so you got to be pretty far east of the highway to have high ground.
Right.
Where that is more than 500 feet, I would guess. But maybe not. That's when we need a map to look at.
Right. Well, I'll print one out for the next one. But you do get into, you're right, there are wetlands. I think it's. Gets into like mass cows and stuff like that.
That's past Scott Road. I'm talking
past,
about between 55
right,
and 56.
Right, right. Okay, yeah.
Right. Of course, then you still end up at Scott Road, and then you have to go through mass cows to get to the bottom.
Well, then you get on Scott Road.
Then you get on Scott Road,
you're
period.
On,
and,
you're
and,
on
yeah,
road,
yeah.
And then you go down and.
The other side of the Highland Road, the old railroad is there. It's not part of the management area.
Right. There was some concern, though, long ago about having riders go on Highfield Road. Yeah, because it's pretty narrow and it's got
this shot.
At least you have to go there. You just have to cross it.
You're saying, so you got to get to the railroad, where the railroad bed crosses Highfield Road from the Martin Burns. See?
You'd have to go down Scotland Road. If
you
go
still, yeah.
If you go up the east side of the highway, and then you'd have to get on Highfield Road to go down, and then get on the right of way there.
Here's Scotland Road, and here's Highfield Road, and here's the old railroad line. So this is all Martin Burns here. And then here's 95 here. So I feel that, and I know there's a curve to me, I know, so I didn't know the curves. Whatever. So this is Scott Road to the industrial park, and here's exit 56. So there's houses along here. Houses all the way actually pretty much. And the new golf place is Jim Well. Maybe there. The wetlands I'm talking about is like around in here, and I just don't know if, you know, I know it's all high ground, most of the Martin Burns, but, you know, you'd have to kind of maybe do one of those, and then go along the golf place, and then hit the tracks there, as opposed to up Scotland Road, so.
I think Pat would have a problem with going that far.
Yeah,
it's,
yeah.
That's a long,
they've been,
yeah.
They've been very concerned even about having any structures close to their property line. That 500 foot line,
yeah,
back even farther.
So you'd ride on Scotland
Road,
maybe have a better bike lane, and then go up to. Okay.
Well,
there's still a concern because of the
job. Yeah, there's concern because of this. So one of the things that Christine was actually looking at for a while was there a way to, you know, maybe come down Parker Street and then cut through the industrial park? There was a kind of open area between a couple of buildings. And, you know, come through that way and
Hale Street. That's not the report, I guess, but.
Which one?
Hale Street.
Hale Street.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, I think the.
Thinking of Jerry Lance, Fields and Colby's Fields.
Right, I mean, that would be taken, the idea was to try to then hook up at the train station to the Clipper City Rail Trail and head down, so, you know, if you kind of wandered through the industrial park and down Parker Street, then you could, then you could do that, if you do Hale Street, then you're going.
You're too far.
You're too far.
Out, yeah, okay, unless you cut through the industrial park from Hale Street.
Right, right, or unless you wanna, you know, do another branch off that goes somewhere, that's not.
That's where.
All we have right now from DOT is to go to Church Street.
Yep.
To Georgetown on to Church Street, and that's it.
Yep.
What if you use Turkey Hill? That could ultimately get you to the train station, just to go around the block.
But, you know, maybe that would be something to. CTC could help us think about ways of connecting.
Mm-hmm. I'll bring it up at the next meeting. We've talked about it some in the past, and a lot of it was just bringing me up to speed on the issues, but. Obviously, from what they've done with all the trails that are under construction, solutions to.
Right, right.
So,
I still want to know that second rail trail across the river across. Millions.
Yep.
I just saw something on the CTC website about that, or the email that they just sent.
The email, yeah. Yep. Picture of what stairway is that they're talking about.
Yeah, me too. Yeah.
It wasn't clear on the map.
I think it's on the new report under where it comes down.
By the filling station?
Well, it was in Amesbury, so it was that old station right in the triangle where.
Yep.
Yeah,
right at the
end. It essentially goes off that way.
Yep.
Yeah, it's visitor center, I think.
Right, right. And so there are two, you know, two big abutments that come down there. So I think the stairway is going up one of them.
I think there's going to be one. They're going to have to do something coming off of the middle of Three Roads.
Ferry.
Yeah, it was
Ferry Road.
I thought they said Ferry Road.
Just before it crosses 95.
I think they're building a ramp.
The rail trail. They're building a ramp, but it's not handicap accessible unless you let a wheelchair get going about 35 miles an hour.
Oh, wow. You think that grade is more than whatever the.
Unless they put, I didn't see any plateaus in it, but I've been looking at it going by and seeing it.
Yeah.
They have to. They need to do it every, I think, 12 inches of rise or something. So.
Each per foot.
Okay.
So, well, that's kind of an interesting idea to think about, possibly. Crossing Central Street, going up the other side. Because we only talked about the west side, we didn't talk anything about the east side.
Well, starting point is get a map and draw the 500 foot corridor and then see what the options are.
Right, right.
See where the wetlands are.
And the other issue that we will still have to deal with at some point is parking.
Yeah.
So the requirement is.
Well, there's no trailhead parking at all. We'll say we had talked about a couple of options. One, if the parcel that the town bought from the McKays, which is right over there, was ever developed, that there could be some trailhead parking there. There are no plans for that. I mean, in truth, there's parking here.
There's also where the station used to be. I'm not sure what the ownership situation of that land
is.
Yeah,
I think that's the one unclear thing, whether it's the Church of the Brethren or not.
So, say you cross Main Street from the trail gets to Byfield Center, and then there's that little church just on the other side, you know, adjacent to the post office. And along the rail bed there, it's kind of, people use it. They use it for parking for the church, they use it for blah, blah, blah. You know, the church might actually be, if, you know, amenable to having improved parking put in there, because, you know, Sunday mornings, they'd probably be their high time for using it, and they'd be the first ones there, generally, before all the bicyclists would get there.
Yeah. And the other 6.5 days of the week, great parking.
Also, I think there's some space they can use by the electric station on Forest Street.
I think we looked at that at one point, and I can't remember if the issue was the wetlands or.
No, I think it was neighbors.
Or access, because the property that's adjacent to it actually comes down. There. But I don't remember what the issues were, but I know that there were some.
Some of the streets in Georgetown, I don't think there's any streets in Newbury that would have butted, but some of the streets in Georgetown and Wright had it.
Right. Well, so I think that's the one that ends right at it. They have.
Yeah, I think that's what. Right, Wells, is that what it's called? Yeah.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, the town had an opportunity, Georgetown did have a land down there, they did. So
maybe we ought to schedule a field trip, you know, we could all get together and walk some of these trails and.
Works for me if I can bring a flower.
Okay.
All right, what are you going to catch?
Anything, doesn't matter, because I throw it all back.
That would be good. I could put some things out on my map that we could look at, both, you know, aerials and maps, and then see them on the ground. Okay.
Move on.
I actually just got some invoices yesterday, so I don't have an updated budget report to give you. But the shortfall that we have is what I said it was actually, it's $2,708. So we've taken in.
So it's more than that. Was it like 1,200 or double up?
Well, the original amount was 12. Our commitment, which was 6.9% of the total cost, was $12,659.
Okay.
We had
$12,659.
Through yard sale proceeds, a grant from CTC, and yard sale was almost $1,000.
And when was that grant from CTC?
That was in 2011.
Oh.
We had a yard sale in 2011, which Christine was instrumental in organizing, and out of that we got $951. We received a new report 5 donation of $1,000. We got the Institution for Savings Charitable Grant for $5,000. And then we also got a grant from CPC specifically for license negotiation. Actually, it wasn't license, but it was negotiation. I think there was also some title. That was $1,250, but that's outside of the so we brought in specific for the trail design $9,951.
Okay.
And so that leaves it $2,708.
All right. Okay. So in the email exchange to Jerry, I brought that up, and CTC is willing to help with that. I don't remember the details of that. Next steps. Figured he was going to be here. He could speak for himself. So. What was the first part? What did you say?
My wife is the president of the organization who runs the Life for Community Ads Center.
Mm-hmm.
It's just functional.
Yep.
Can use it for anything we want as long as it's legal.
Mm-hmm. Unlike past history, that was.
Wasn't me.
Right. So that's a great idea because it's right next to the driveway.
Train right by that one town in Everett.
It's going to be huge.
Yeah.
I guess the one in Springfield is going to open first.
Wow.
Yeah, that's what I heard.
But I mean, I don't know what kind of fundraiser we can do. We can hire an entertainer, just mm-hmm. put on a show, and between sets, get up and give a spiel about donating. Whatever you charge for ticket price would be as anyhow, so they don't want to make any money on it. So.
Threaten to book Barry Manilow over here to sing unless people give us money. If they give us enough money, we won't
do it. I got fly fishing engagement that weekend. Think about it, come up with some ideas of what we can do.
All for it?
Yes.
So.
All right, well, I guess that's maybe a part of the next steps.
Possible fundraising ideas. On the trail, benches, because none of that's going to be covered.
Can broaden your target audience if you invite Georgetown to do it with us.
Yep. Georgetown Savings Bank is now Salem 5. I wonder if they tapped into them. Maybe we could send a letter. Bigger pockets now.
I think, yeah. Remember, we talked about that back in 2016, and I should. That'd be another reason for me to dust off, and update the brand app that we use for institutions so that we can maybe start throwing grant applications around. Places and hope we catch something. Unlike you, fly fishing, we won't throw it back if we do. So. you know, it would help Georgetown by having a through connection trail. So. I guess it's in the memo of understanding once that's hammered out is that shell game with the money that, you know, has that. I think we're going to need to explain that clearly to the selectmen.
Yes, absolutely.
So you, one of the first things you're going to do is share your status document or whatever you call it that you were working on.
Yeah, let me get that. You know, try and get that out.
That you and I talked about that several months ago.
This weekend, maybe.
Thought something like that useful, and you said you had something like that already. So
yeah.
It's just really handy to have something that everybody can look at and know
well, yeah,
where we stand, so we don't have to go rehash everything.
It could be kind of the beginning or of a living. We have that
yep.
update as we need, but
right.
it's there in color,
yep.
flashy little maps. So.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know where the actual boundary of the Martin Burns is, but I just know we, like, I live on Orchard Street, so we hiked out back to the